We are here this morning to obviously talk about the YDD program, the Youth Development Delinquency Program, as well as equally as important, the impact of the proposed minimum wage increase on the Summer Youth Employment Program. As many of you know, the Summer Youth Employment Program is a very critical program for young people throughout the state of New York. And we believe there has not been enough attention or enough analysis that has been done with regard to the impact of a minimum wage on the Summer Youth Employment Program. We all support the idea of increasing the minimum wage, and what we don't want to get lost, in particular if the minimum wage is increased between now and June, what we don't want to get lost is the fact that there could be a regressive impact on the number of slots that become available for the Summer Youth Program, in that most people don't equate the amount of money that is coming for the Summer Youth Program to as a whole number versus what that would mean if minimum wage was increased. So we have a number of people who will be testifying today. Jeannie Mulgrave, the Commissioner of the New York City Department of Youth. Andrew Miller, the Assistant Commissioner, New York City Department of Youth. Jackie Negri, Executive Director of Association of New York State Youth Bureau. Dr. Nora Eichner, who's the New York State After School Network. Mr. Kevin Alexander, Rockaway Development Corporation. Mr. Kevin Douglas, United Neighborhood Houses of New York. And Dr. Amy Schwartz, Institute for Education and Social Policy. So with that, let me ask my colleague, Senator Martin, I'd like to say a few words, and then we'll move into our testimony.
No, it's critically important that when we do look to make policy changes, that we also look at the consequences of those changes and the impact on those changes on those programs that most affect people in need. There are great programs out there. We just want to make sure that policies are consistent, and looking forward to the testimony today. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Okay. With that, let's bring up our first two testifiers, Commissioner Jeannie Mulgrave and Assistant Commissioner Andrew Miller. And as you know, chivalry is not dead, even though she does have the supreme title of commissioner. So we obviously will go with the commissioner first, and we'll have testimony, and then there'll be questions, obviously, if any one of my colleagues who are here have questions, and then we'll go from there.
Good morning, and thank you, Senator Smith. We've worked together for many, many years. I know your commitment not only to the Summer Youth Employment Program, but to all youth development funding and programs, and I want to thank you for your leadership in convening this hearing. I also want to thank the members of the Senate Committee on Social Services, as well as Senator Martins. I am Jeannie Mulgrave, Commissioner of the New York City Department of Youth and Community Development, and thank you for the opportunity to testify today about the Youth Development and Delinquency Prevention Program and the Summer Youth Employment Program. This is my third visit this session because the state support is so critical to the provision of services of New York young people. As you know, DYCD receives state funding for YDDP, SYEP, and the Runaway and Homeless Youth Program. There's a lot of feedback. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's fine.
All right. Unfortunately, state funding sources have shrunk considerably over the past several years and now represent only 5% of DYCD's total budget. This has made it more challenging for DYCD and youth bureaus across the state to provide needed youth services. YDDP is our only state funding source for the out-of-school time program. As the attached charts demonstrate, YDDP funding to the city has declined by 61% from $10.5 million in city fiscal year 2007 to $4.1 million in city fiscal year 13. During the same period, thanks to the partnership of Mayor Michael R. Bloomberg and the City Council, city tax levy funding to OST increased 70% from $58.5 million to $99.5 million. The OST system currently serves about 56,000 young people from kindergarten to high school in programs located in every neighborhood across the city. to maximize public dollars, programs are in schools, community centers, settlement houses, cultural institutions, libraries, public housing facilities, and parks. OST promotes academic achievement, the healthy development and resiliency of all young people, and helps working parents. Likewise, state funding to RHY dropped 60% over those 6 years, from about $2 million to $778,000. To make up this gap and to enhance services, we work with the City Council, and the city increased its investment in the RHY continuum by 64%, from $6.7 million to $11 million. As you know, DYCD's RHY continuum of services is designed to protect runaway and homeless youth, reunite them with their families wherever possible, and help youth achieve self-sufficiency. We're proud of our success enhancing services by doubling bed capacity and offering specialized services for LGBTQ and pregnant and sexually exploited youth. State funding to SYEP contracted by the lowest proportion of our funding streams. It was reduced by 36% from $21 million in fiscal year 07 to $13.5 million in fiscal year 13. The mayor's commitment remains strong, and he baselined SYEP funding at $20.5 million while raising additional private funds. We appreciate the governor and legislature's increase in SYEP appropriation last year, bringing the statewide total from $15.5 million, good morning, to $25 million in 2013, and also are pleased to see that increased funding level, the increased funding level this year. We support the governor's budget proposal to merge SYDDP with the Special Delinquency Prevention Program and to streamline its distribution, and we're encouraged by the efforts to make the program more efficient. In this regard, we recommend that funding be allocated to youth bureaus, which already administer eligible programs and will benefit from additional state funding. Unfortunately, the governor's proposed language does not specify a formula for distribution of the grants. Currently, OCFS distributes the funds on a per capita basis. We believe that the size of the youth population should remain an important component of the formula. In order to target funds to needy, at-risk youth, we also encourage the state to include the number of youth living in poverty in its formula. As you know, the governor's budget includes an increase to $8.75 effective July 1, and the Assembly has passed an increase to $9 effective January 1. We are supportive of increasing the minimum wage in order to help raise the standard of living for low-income New Yorkers. However, it's important to note that an increase in the minimum wage will have the unintended consequence of decreasing the number of young people we could serve through a SYEP. We estimate that at the current rate, we can employ 30,000 young people this summer. The wage increase would cut this number by approximately 4,500. To make up the gap and allow SYEP programs statewide to continue to provide the same level of service, we estimate that the statewide appropriation should be at least $35 million, which is the same level of funding provided by the state in 2009 and before. This funding would be well spent, considering that last summer, 75% of our participants indicated that they would not have a job without SYEP. Additionally, a recent report by NYU demonstrated that SYEP improves school attendance and academic achievement, and we're pleased that NYU will be testifying before the committee today to highlight those positive results. I'm also delighted to report that we have awarded new SYEP contracts that will begin April 1 and will build on the progress made during the past 10 years. Innovations will allow us to tailor the program to particular needs of youth in different age ranges and with special needs. The program will include 4 service areas for youth age 14 and 15, for youth age 16 through 24, for vulnerable youth, and will expand our very successful unsubsidized corporate internship program. Finally, I urge the legislature to include funding to serve sexually exploited youth through the Safe Harbor Act. This year's budget included $1.5 million, and the city received $622,000, and we're pleased to be working with the New York City Administration for Children's Services to expand street outreach services, provide summer jobs, for sexually exploited youth and provide case management and increase the competency of youth workers who encounter sexually exploited youth. I want to again thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I am joined by Andrew Miller, Assistant Commissioner for External Relations at DYCD, and we'd be happy to answer your questions.
Well, before we, are you making a statement?
He will be answering questions with me.
And before we go to question and answer, we're joined by my colleague, Senator Sanders, and before the members to make an opening statement of some kind, please.
Be glad to. I'll speak up. First, let me begin by thanking the great Senator Smith for doing this hearing. We needed this desperately. This is a subject that is quickly coming on us. The hiring of our youth during the summer months. I, for one, have felt that New York City and state, for that matter, was not doing enough, that the budget was insufficient, that we need to do more. I want to thank our great commissioner and the assistant commissioner for being here. I trust that the trip north was not very bad or harsh on you, but I hope that it's rewarding. I hope that you come out of here not just with knowledge, but with an understanding that state government wants to do more with you. We feel that we are partners with you for the betterment of the entire community. So having said that, I will let this hearing continue. And again, thank you, Senator Smith.
My pleasure. Questions, Senator Martin?
Sure. The impact of a potential increase in minimum wage to the program, I think, is pretty clear. But you're asking for additional funding, or appropriate, at least $35 million for the program. How did you arrive at those numbers?
We just basically looked at what, you know, what those slots would cost and how to back into, you know, the numbers that we had previously.
The typical summer youth program participant, how many hours are they participating? How many hours are they being paid for the summer months? What are we talking about?
They're generally working about 25 hours
a week.
And in addition to that, they're getting educational workshops that help support the skill building that's happening on the job.
So they're getting paid for 25 hours, or do they also get compensated for the period of time that they're taking lessons? I'm just trying to.
Our younger students are not getting compensated for the work readiness, and that's because it really is an investment in their overall skill set and you know, an educational piece. It's not a work related piece.
So out of the 30,000 participants, how many of those are in each class? Do you know? Do you have a breakdown?
We have that information. We have, in terms of younger youth, we have a projected enrollment of about 6,500. Vulnerable youth, who are young people who might be court involved, who might be aging out of foster care, who might be coming out of state facilities, we have a projected enrollment of about 1,000. Older youth, that would be 16 to 24, 15,335. And ladders for leaders, which is the unsubsidized jobs program, that's about 400. If you're doing math quickly, you'll realize that that doesn't come to 30,000, and that's because our contracts, we issued contracts at the amount that we had at the time, which was about 23,000. We know that we will be allocating a second wave of about 7,000 slots to these various components of the initiative.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Senator Sanders.
Thank you, sir. It does speak well for Mayor Bloomberg and for the City Council to have
City
increased.
Council?
Well.
You know something about that, huh?
Well, I must admit, as a former city council member and a mayoral appointee, in full disclosure, to the board, I know a little something of these matters, and I personally took great pride in increasing the budget of the city to support these great activities that we are doing as we try to prepare for the next generation, as I will try to take great pride in helping the state understand its worthy value. But as I was not alone then, I am joined by some of the best that the state offers up here, including Senator Martin with those very nice cufflinks. So under those conditions, I look forward to making sure that the best that we can do for our youth will be done here. Is there any message that you would like to leave with the state on in terms of why it should increase, or do you believe that they should increase YDDP? Let me not assume.
Absolutely. I think we have done the work to make these programs evidence-based, to make them accountable, to make sure that the state and the city, of course, is getting its bang for the buck. We know to the extent that these programs help with the social and emotional development of young people, with the academic skill building. And now we are seeing also a nexus between employment and academic achievement, which, you know, we used to see these as sort of siloed initiatives, and now we are realizing that what is gleaned over the summer by having a job makes that job make school more meaningful when they return in the fall. And I know you'll be looking forward to hearing from the NYU professors who did this work. So it's clear that these are beneficial programs. That doesn't also include, you know, the impact that it has for working parents who can feel secure knowing that their children are actively engaged and are safe, and they are more productive on the job. And, of course, you know, the investment, you know, the more you work today, the more you work tomorrow. So we know that your income is likely to be higher when you have those early work experiences, and that money gets invested right back in the community. Young people are good at spending, we know that, and guess where they spend it? They spend it right, you know, right where they live, and that's important. And so for all those reasons and probably more, we believe these programs are a good investment.
With your permission.
Sure.
Assistant Commissioner Miller, these are worthy goals, but how would you respond to a person who says that although these goals are worthy, in a time of economic troubles, we cannot afford them? How would you respond to such a person?
Well, I would say these are the absolute times you should invest in young people, because an investment in today, an investment of a dollar today will glean benefits for that young person, for the city, for many years to come. So it's a wise investment. It's a small investment for the benefits that we do ultimately get for the young people. And you should do it today.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Thank you. I just have just a couple of questions. The 4,500 number, is that New York City?
That's New York City.
Statewide.
So,
okay, because yes. We had a number of close to 10,000 statewide, which we assume would be impacted by.
Makes sense.
Make sure, I was just checking on my staff, make sure those numbers is right. How did yours say 4,500?
Right.
Right, yours is New York City. Commissioner, has there been another point in time where you had to deal with this similar situation, whereas the minimum wage was being increased? I know it was increased a few years back. What was that impact on the program, and how did you deal with that?
We did have to deal with it previously, and unfortunately, I think at that point, we saw reductions. Do you remember what year exactly?
We just raised it in 2000. And, I don't know, it was 9.
That's what I was thinking. It probably was. I think it might have been masked by
stimulus monies.
Okay.
That's, I mean, as I'm trying to think back, and we can certainly get you those details. But I think we probably didn't feel the impact as great. As you may remember, with stimulus support, we were able to have a program that was over 50,000. And we haven't seen those numbers since before the year 2000, and that's coincides with the federal government really abandoning SYEP.
And so 2009, I think we all agree, was when that increase was there, and it was mitigated by the stimulus money. And I believe that stimulus money was covered like a year or two, if I'm not mistaken. So I'm assuming there's a one-year gap somewhere in there. But are you saying during that time period there was no reduction in summer youth in terms of the numbers that were involved?
Well, ultimately, when you don't have the additional funding, then you're seeing your numbers drop. I mean, prior to that, we generally had a program that was at about 40 to 41,000. As you hear now, we're looking at a program of 30,000. That pales next to the interest in the program, which is always about 130,000. So we are saying no to about 100,000 young people every summer.
So if the amount for summer youth this year is 25 million, correct? And you're saying if you receive an additional 10 million, that 35 million would allow you to, with a minimum wage increase, would allow you to still bring on 30,000 young people? Okay. On the number of young people that we're talking about hiring for this year, what is the timetable? And let me frame that a little bit better. We are most likely going to finish our budget, and these are going to be two kind of hypothetical what-ifs, and I'm assuming you may have a model or two that you might have used to come to some conclusion. But let's assume we do our budget by the 22nd or the 25th, whichever. Two questions. One, if the minimum wage is in the budget, what is that turnaround time for you if, in fact, those numbers aren't there? And then let's say the minimum wage is not in the budget, and let's say we got to doing the minimum wage sometime in May or June. Is there a window in which, because I know you have to make announcements also about your summer youth slots, and people have to start applying and what have you. So if, let's take the worst case scenario, let's just say we don't pass the minimum wage until May or June, what does that do to the number of slots? Is that enough time for you to put in place a contingency plan to say, oh, okay, we can get those additional youths, or do we lose that for this year?
We have, because our system is used to contracting and expanding, we have the ability to do it, infuse new money very quickly, unfortunately, to contract very quickly. So, you know, we have that capacity. But again, I'm speaking about, you know, our system in New York City, which tends to be much, much larger than any other jurisdiction we have in the state. And so I would think that most other jurisdictions might not have that ability. And so, you know, I mean, all of us, with more time, there's better planning. I mean, I can't state that enough.
Right.
But of course, we're able to absorb resources very, very quickly. And part of it is that we have the base contract, which I just gave you those numbers, and then the vendors that we have selected, the CBOs that we're working with, are used to being able to kind of ratchet up very quickly.
Just one other question. On the age, 16 to 24, how did we get I mean, you know, for those that are 24, I'm sure they're happy they still call youth. But
I'm trying to fit in myself.
You're never interested in
that.
So just out of curiosity, what was the rationale, reasoning for getting to 24 as opposed to 16 to 19 or 16 to 21? And I don't think it's a bad thing, but I just want to know what was an understanding.
Sure. In 2009, when we benefited from stimulus, the terms of that arrangement included going up to 24. There's a real recognition across the country that older and older young people are less able to be self-sufficient, less prepared for the workforce, and you know, just spending more time living at home, you know, just getting married later, those kinds of things. And so this was a recognition of helping young people who still weren't able to secure a job on their own. That being said, once the stimulus money disappeared, we stayed with the 24 number just because of the recession. We had a lot of college students who weren't able to find work. And we also took a look at the numbers, and it still, at the end of the day, represented a small portion of what we do. So it wasn't, you know, taking away from the bulk of the students who are going to be between, you know, 14 and 18.
Okay, I do have just one other final. On the 4,500, is there a formula by which, if for any reason we didn't have the resources to get you back to the 35 million, and believe me, we are aggressively pursuing trying to make that happen. Do we have an idea of how that 4,500 would be reduced? Is a formula based for each borough, or is it, how is that determined?
It would be based on the number of slots that they have to begin with. And the percentage of slots that they have vis-a-vis the total. But we still have, for example, we still have about, as I said, approximately 7,000 slots to distribute because we weren't certified for the amount that we have in the bank now because we have the state money. And so what we might do is, instead of giving out 7,000, give 7,000 minus 4,500. So, but we will do it in an equitable way.
Any other follow-up questions?
Sure. You raised a great point, Chairman. How are the slots divided now? I mean, out of the 30,000 slots that you have, or 23,000 or whatever it happens to be, let's say 30, Is it divided proportionately by population? Is there some other factor? You know, there are different parts of the city, obviously. How do you address the division of those slots? I mean, how many are going to Staten Island as opposed to the Bronx or Brooklyn?
Well, the Bronx has 21.7%. Brooklyn has 31.9%, Manhattan has 19.7%, Queens has 22.1%, and Staten Island has 4.6%. And that's based on population and also, I think, poverty.
Just one last question. We're discussing specifically the summer youth employment program. If there were an increase in minimum wage, would there be any other impacts to any other programs that you provide besides the summer youth program?
Yes. We have other workforce programs, including the young adult internship program that is a longer term. It's modeled on the Summer Youth Employment Program, but is a 12-week internship program for young people who are termed disconnected, who are not in school and are not working. And this happens during the school year. And that program, supported by the Center for Economic Opportunity, would also be impacted.
Thank you.
How big would the impact be? Just curious now. Have you done any study to how widespread, how large the impact would be on the other programs?
We certainly can get back to you with that impact.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
All right, thank you, Commissioner. Let me thank you and your Assistant Commissioner. For the record, we appreciate your commitment to the youth of the city. Obviously, you've done a tremendous job from all that I've heard and from others. Know that we are committed to working with you. We are going to be pushing for an increase in the Summer Youth Employment Program as well as YDDP. We can't tell you today how that's going to work out, but I know our One House resolution is coming out. I would ask that you pay close attention to it and give us support necessary should it have the language in there that might be worthwhile to you. But we appreciate what you have done. I'm sure the youth of the city and the state, for that matter, because you've been a model across the state. I appreciate what you have done. You as well, Commissioner. Thank you.
Thank you for your kind words. Thank you.
Jackie Negree, is she here? Okay. Jackie Negree is the Executive Director of the Association of New York State Youth Bureaus.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Thank you. I have with me today our lobbyist, Andrea Smith. I'm going to
listen for the record, just so you know.
With a Y, Smith with a Y for the record. I'm going to focus my remarks today on the Youth Development Delinquency Prevention Program. The Association of New York State Youth Bureaus represents over 107 youth bureaus statewide. We represent county youth bureaus as well as municipal youth bureaus in cities, towns, and villages.
Do we have any copies of your testimony?
I emailed it earlier.
It should be up there.
Okay.
No worries. Okay, well, proceed.
Yeah, proceed. we serve 1.5 million youth statewide. We're very proud of that number. We have programs at both the county and city, state, and local village level, town level, that run the gamut of youth development and prevention. We have programs and services that allow for youth development, allow for teen pregnancy prevention, career readiness, after school programs, high school academic preparedness. We have programs that serve these children who are primarily high-risk youth across the state. Our services are at jeopardy because over the past 6 years, we have been cut by over 65% statewide. The YDDP program, the Youth Development Program, as well as a special delinquency detention program, they have been cut over 65% from 38 million about 6 years ago to now a total combination of 14 million. However, I have to say that the youth bureaus have continued to provide services. The youth bureaus also contract. Sometimes it's confusing the way our funding streams run, but we're the ones who hand out the money too, the Boys and Girls Clubs, the YMCAs, all of the local nonprofits, as well as ourselves having services and programs where the youth can come right to our doorstep. Considering the cuts over the years, it's been very difficult because programs have been cut. We have allowed opportunities that have helped in our youth to now be tailored back. And it's a difficult thing when a youth is knocking at the door and there's no programs and there's no place for them to go. So over the years, we have thought we cannot continue with this 50% cut, 25% cut, et cetera, which the executive has laid out for us year after year after year. The proposal in the budget combines YDDP and SDPP and puts it together in a youth development program. We do see some benefits to this and support it with amendments because one of the things that we are very concerned about is that this money gets then pooled into a fund and becomes a slush fund that a county can use to fill in their gaps. And that's not what we're looking for. Nor do we assume that that's what the counties will do, but we want to make sure that there are clear provisions that these monies go to youth bureaus and continue for youth services. So some of our concerns with the language as is we want to make sure that the Youth Bureau system itself stays intact. This system has been placed for many, many years, and it's actually recognized nationally as one of the best youth development systems in the country. It allows for local flexibility, it allows for local decision making, and allows for comprehensive planning. So with that, we'd like to continue to make sure that the funding is streamlined. Now would be streamlined through the county youth bureaus. The way the formula currently works, the county youth bureaus receive the money, and then the municipal youth bureaus, your cities, towns, and villages, also get a piece of that funding. We understand the need for streamlining. We understand the need for mandate relief. If it does go through the county, we want to make sure it goes through the youth bureau. And then for our municipal youth bureaus, who have been receiving monies for many years, this is a change for them. And I can say they're thrilled with the change, but with change comes opportunity. And with us now, the opportunity is concrete outcome measurements that relay to positive youth development outcomes. We as an association have worked with counties, a pilot of 10 statewide, to allow for results-based accountability. We have software programs that we're working with the county so that they can determine where their funding is going and specifically know what type of positive outcomes are needed in that community and make sure those outcomes are achieved in order for them to continue to receive the funding. What we're asking also is that the municipals continue to have a seat at the table. The way that the language is written is that municipal youth bureaus now, you could have, for example, a county youth bureau receive the money the way the new language is written, and maybe not even invite, if it goes through the county, the city or the town to the table. We want to make sure that all of the youth bureaus that are already intact, that their program and services are at least allowed for as part of the comprehensive planning process. Understanding they may not get funding, but their needs of those youth that are in small towns and villages across the state should also be addressed. And if they are addressed, they would be able to sit at that table, and even if they're not getting the funding that they've received. In addition, we are hoping that the restorations that you have graciously put in and led over the past few years, especially last year, there was a 1.5 restoration that was put in, that you continue to, I think in your Senate bill, you've asked for restorations, and we're very thrilled for that. I hope during negotiations that those stay on the table, because this would allow for at least the funding, regardless if the youth program, development program goes through, it allow for the funding to maintain at last year's levels. And we really don't see how we can, maintain any more cuts as we move forward, especially if we're going to put in outcome measures and start to really sort of beef up our game as far as measuring what services are going out the door and how we account for the funding that comes in for those services.
I think that's an important point that Jackie's making, is that we assume that part of the Senate's willingness to put in a restoration that's even higher than what last year's would have been is related to the fact that the governor's office is mandating that there be outcome measurements included in the program going forward. And we had asked that the legislature fund that so it wouldn't be an unfunded mandate on the counties and the city, but yet there would be some assistance in buying the software and being able to develop the reporting system. And we do appreciate that the Senate proposed restoration appears to have addressed that concern.
Those are our, I think, major concerns related to the YDDP. I'll let Andrea speak a little bit to summer youth employment. The commissioner gave you the data for downstate, but we represent the youth bureaus statewide, and they do administer summer youth employment programs.
Full disclosure, for about 10 years, I was the lobbyist for the campaign for summer jobs, so I think I know a little bit about this. First of all, I think that the increase in the minimum wage will impact both the employment opportunities for young people within the YDDP program upstate and with the summer youth employment program. A lot of the YDDP programs that we run for out of school time during the summer employ young people in upstate counties. And, the Bureau of Labor Statistics map will show you that some of the highest unemployment rate, youth unemployment rates, are in the North Country and in small counties
in the western part of the state. So we can get you that specific information, but it's the New York State Department of Labor Statistics. Yes, I am.
So, you know, and in response to the question that you asked, Commissioner Mulgrave, regarding to the ability upstate to respond quickly, I don't think that the administrative strength of some of the counties and municipal youth bureaus is as nimble as the infrastructure in the city. And so probably, you know, my best guess as to what's happened and what did happen in other years is that youth who were notified that they would be employed would then be notified that they could not be employed, or midstream, early in, you know, at the end of July, they would be told that there was no additional funding to continue the program for the rest of the summer. And so our concerns about those types of impacts are significant. Even though the population is a smaller number of youth, you know, just referring to the poverty statistics in upstate communities, these may be the only employment opportunities available to vulnerable youth. And even, you know, upstate youth who are in marginally financially stable families, and there are just not a lot of youth opportunities, and these jobs are very important to the communities and to the development. The educational awareness of kids who, for the first time, see a workplace and see the skills that you need, and they can correlate that to the need to try a little bit harder and do well in school, I think is, you know, one of the greatest benefits of the employment aspects of both YDDP and summer youth employment.
I just want to close by saying we have the privilege of meeting these kids, and they're such good kids. I mean, you know, when we work go statewide from the going way out west to Olean and the Indian reservations where we see a real rural New York, and then right through to the cities that we work with, these kids are kids that are looking for a place to go. And they've been dealt a card at a very young age. And everyone is dealt a card, but to have that card dealt so young, I think is very difficult. So your continued support to allow for the programs and services across the state to see these kids through to success, to be ready to work when they get out of high school or college, to be able to graduate from high school, and to be able to stay off of the drugs that are laid out in front of them on a daily basis is more than appreciated. And it's really great to have, I feel blessed to have that opportunity to meet and see these kids through and hear their success stories afterwards. So we hope that as we go through this change, which is a major change for Youth Bureau system as far as funding, that our primary concern is to keep systems in place so that at the end of the day, we're not about keeping jobs in place, and it's difficult. These Youth Bureau directors have been along a long time to say, they have always said first, it's not about our jobs, it's not about keeping us solvent, it's about the, you know, the services for the kids. And that's what we want to make sure that we don't lose during this process.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much for your testimony. Questions?
Sure.
Senator Martin.
Thank you. You know, we're all familiar with the youth programs that are available in our own communities, and certainly how important they are. More often than not, especially in our communities, that are more socioeconomically disadvantaged, you do have both parents working. You do need to make sure that you have an infrastructure in place that allows the community to buttress and keep children safe and actively engaged. And I've seen, obviously, the effects of those programs firsthand and the positive effect of those programs firsthand. As we look at it, you know, statewide, and certainly we have focused on, you know, New York City, but we, as we do look in upstate New York and in suburban communities around the city, the model has traditionally been working through the counties. And, you know, I've seen, or at least heard some hesitancy in your testimony that perhaps that model is failing us, or that you may have some concerns with regard to that model going forward. How would you suggest we approach that?
I may have misspoke. Going through the counties, we support the youth bureaus going through the counties. We want to make sure it goes through the county youth bureau. And that's where I think the disconnect is. With the language that was put forth, there's repeal of youth bureau language that's set within. So we want to keep what you have said, that structure intact. So that's what we're concerned about, is to make sure through this youth development program funding stream, it continues to go through the county to the County Youth Bureau, and then have the, specifically, right, and then have the Youth Bureau be the one through their comprehensive planning process to determine what the need is. That would allow for flexibility. We believe the counties have, they know best what's needed in their county, but to allow for the towns and the cities and the villages within that county to also be part of that process. So it's more the Youth Bureau, I think, that I try to get across.
Sure.
Yeah.
Keep it going through the county, but not a general grant. Make sure that the language is in the appropriation, specifically targeting the monies through the counties, through their Youth Bureau, so that the money cannot, and we're not saying it will be, but right. So that it cannot be used for some other purpose.
For some other purpose, exactly. And also, there's a lot in the language, it gives a lot of authority to the executive for regulation, development, et cetera. We know everything has to be redone. We believe that youth bureaus and youth development stakeholders should have a seat at that table, so that that should be in consultation with the industry, so that those who know best, that are on the ground doing the programs and services, are able to make sure when we get words to paper that it actually does not have a negative effect on the kids that we serve. So we're also asking to have that opportunity for consultation, to be at the table, to make sure that this, even though we're doing more of a paper relief and mandate relief and streamlining of funding, let's not have it impact negatively on the kids that we serve.
The performance standards that you spoke of, and I don't know if there's a formal rubric that's been developed on that yet, or if the community is being asked to develop that on their own, which is a bit odd. But you know, could you share your thoughts with regard to you know, what kind of metrics do you expect will be used in terms of developing that rubric, being able to evaluate those performance metrics, and whether or not, you know, we're dealing with a very large state. There are so many different communities out there. Each community knows specifically how best to address the youth programs in their communities. They know what the dynamics are of those communities, and certainly I don't think a one-size-fits-all approach is fair under these circumstances, especially given all the different variables that we face, not only statewide, but certainly in each one of our own communities, there are variables. How do we measure that and still be consistent?
We have been working with a group called Results-Based Accountability and basing the outcome measures and the goals that we've put together on New York State touchstones, which are 8 features of positive youth development. Those features include education, citizenship, career readiness, for some examples. So by allowing for those general New York State touchstones, 8 features, which a lot of the offices have encompassed and embraced, then our tool allows for specific outcome measurements based on those general goals. And that's to your point of having it specific to what the county's needs are. So for example, there may be a goal in there on career readiness that teams up with the Big Brothers and Big Sisters. And then for that specific county in town, they would, excuse me, have that included in their goal, in their outcomes, and then they would have measurable, attainable results. For example, percentage of kids who graduate from high school may be one of the attainable results. Percentage of kids who have maybe the workforce credentialing, gone through that. They have specific ones tailored to the need. So it's actually, we can share with you the tool that we've been using. We've had a pilot in 10 counties statewide, and it's been very effective. Those who are involved within the youth bureaus are very pleased with the results. And we are pleased because now we can start to pull statewide and demonstrate here and these, you know, take a sampling of counties and say, here's what the percentage of youth who have graduated through high school have participated in these programs. Here's the percentage who have career readiness skills or mentoring skills. So that's what we've been doing. But your point's well taken. It has to be specific to the needs of those individualized counties.
We think that the outcome measures will allow a county with a pocket of kids who are engaging in risky behaviors would be able to tailor programs and identify risk aversion to, you know, their county's priorities. That's the whole value of having the comprehensive plan and having the inclusion of all of the existing youth bureaus, whether or not they're going to be funded. They may have an expertise that when it comes time to develop the comprehensive plan, you know, a small city municipal youth bureau would be able to be with the county developing the plan, raising that risk population, and being able to make sure that that population gets addressed. That's exactly our goal.
So if I understand it correctly, there's a baseline, but even in that baseline, there is enough flexibility mm-hmm. so that each county or each group can target those areas that are most important or most in need for that particular community.
Mm-hmm. And that's the benefits of this proposal if the amendments are made and it goes through in the best case scenario, because then those counties would be allowed to have specific goals based on need in the county. Right now, there's a sort of outdated formula where the monies go to not only the county, but also the municipals, and there really isn't a standard for accountability. What this does do is allow for that accountability based on the outcomes, but again, keeping it enough flexibility so that what's good in the western part of rural New York may not necessarily be the same need in the city of Albany. And we need to make sure that the monies are spent in such a way that they allow for that need.
And we've worked with your staff on developing that language. We didn't see that bill yet, but we're hopeful that the needs will be addressed. And we support Commissioner Mulgrave's concern about poverty being and population and poverty being some of the distribution formula considerations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I mean, Commissioner, I'm sorry.
Well, it sounded good. Ms. Negri, you spoke of the need for clear provisions to ensure that money, of course, is not diverted by the counties. Has this happened in days gone by?
No, but in the past, the Youth Bureau was in statute. And now, the way that the language is written, it repeals portions of that statute. So we're a little overly cautious, overly concerned to make sure that the process in which the monies get distributed continue to be the process that has been in place for that many years. Although it'll be consolidated and streamlined and go through the counties and let them make the decisions, which is fine, we just want to make sure we don't lose anything within the language, and I think that's what our intent was in bringing that to your attention.
Thank you. Well, I'm still a commissioner, I'll stop.
You think just as similar to the increase in minimum wage, which we obviously are working towards, there was very little attention to the unintended consequences of the loss of slots when that happens. You support the YDDP merging. And I just wonder if, because we're not the experts in there, obviously you guys live this every single day. Has there been any analysis on your part on any unintended consequences that we might have not thought about, that next year you don't come back to us or we don't have a discussion saying, well, you know what, now we've got to separate the two, or it's not working, and not to say that you can't anticipate everything, but when you heard of the merger and then obviously you did an analysis and looked at it, is there any window of unintended consequence that you may have saw that we can try to make sure that we take into consideration now so that we don't do typically what government does, which is have to go back and fix it again, spend more money when we could have just taken a little time to be smarter and do it all at one time?
We did mention the possible need of a sunset date to make sure that we have thoroughly had the opportunity to analyze this and make sure it's working, because it would be new for a system that's been around for many, many years. Yeah, so we did have conversations with your staff into that regards and think that may be a benefit to this whole process, because it's hard to anticipate, anticipate everything. And everyone wants the same thing. They want the programs and services for those kids to not be interrupted.
So if I may, when as you're going through your morphing, so to speak, if all occurs as we asked, if you would keep us informed, obviously how it is working. One thing I will say that we've managed to become pretty nimble in our operations and our ability to shift given the current
fiscal climate that we're in, we have to be nimble enough to shift so that we don't lose too much going forward or get locked into losing. If there's something that you see is not working or it ends up having a negative impact on the youth and its programming and or the fiscal side of it, we would only ask that you would let us know as quickly as you believe you have all the necessary foundation and evidence to back up what it is you're recommending.
We appreciate that openness, and we certainly will continue to, you know, keep you informed. And again, thank you for your ongoing support.
Any other follow-up questions?
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Dr. Eichner, you better not miss Kevin Alvin.
Dr. Nora.
Dr. Nora Eichner.
All right, so thank you so much for inviting us here today and for holding this hearing. I think these are some incredibly important changes in some of these funding streams. That's really wonderful to have the opportunity to address. So I'm Nora Nijelski-Eichner with the New York State After School Network, and we represent providers across the state who work on serving students through after school and summer programming, both who receive state funds and who don't. But we spend a particular amount of time thinking very thoughtfully to the extent that we are able to about the state funding streams. So we are partnered with the Association for the New York State Youth Bureaus. We're very lucky that they participate with us as well. So I don't want to duplicate Jackie's testimony, but I do want to highlight a few points and then talk a little bit about how some of these funding streams and these potential changes impact the broader after-school community. So I did really want to reemphasize, along with Jackie, that we think it's very important that the youth bureaus remain in existence, remain an important part of this process. We certainly understand the need for county flexibility, but they have been in existence for a very long time, do tremendous work across the state, and it's crucial that this funding really be directed to organizations that have substantial youth development experience. It's not in any way to cast aspersions on the counties or to doubt the best interests of those there, but we all know that expertise is something that is built up over time, and particularly when you're talking about some of the most vulnerable populations in the state, it's really crucial that decisions stay housed with those who have a lot of vested interest in youth development. Along those same lines, we also really want to reiterate the incredible importance that the counties include the cities, towns, and villages in these conversations. There are a number of city and village youth bureaus across the state who have done tremendous work over the years. They are very invested in their students. They know a great deal about the micro differences between what's happening in Glen Cove and what's happening in Hempstead. Mm-hmm. And those things really matter enormously when you're trying to plan a program that is intended to reach a wide range of youth at the sort of lowest possible cost for the maximum output. So we really are hopeful that that language will recognize that the comprehensive planning process does need to include those local voices. We also really want to reiterate the importance of public process and public transparency on the distribution formula for these funds. We recognize, again, that as this is a new funding stream or with this consolidation, that it's going to take some time for decisions to be made. But it's really important that this conversation involve those who are familiar with the on-the-ground situation, who know the ins and outs. You know, this has always been a funding stream that has had some, because of the running on a different cycle than the fiscal year and other things like that, that sounds simple in explanation, but the practical on-the-ground realities can be very complex, and having folks who have nuanced experience with implementing that will be very important. We also want to reiterate the value of the $1.28 million addition that the youth bureaus are requesting because these programs have been hit so hard over the last few years. Every penny counts. When I talk to programs that we work with across the state, they often are getting, you know, dollars from their youth bureau programs that are, you know, $5,000 here, $10,000 there, sometimes only a couple thousand, and they really do need those funds. They use them for things that they can't otherwise do. So every penny that can be squeezed out really will be acknowledged and valued. I also really want to follow up on Jackie's points about outcomes. we have a tremendous opportunity here to take a lead in the nation in really thinking about how you track youth outcomes in a way that engages with the complexity of what youth need, that doesn't reduce their experiences to one or two factors, to test scores here or, you know, an employment placement there, but really look at the range of things that really do impact their ability to grow into productive citizens. So the work that the youth bureaus have done on these outcomes has been very impressive so far and has, I think, a tremendous value in allowing it to be carried forward, again, in a way that there are resources for full implementation. This is not necessarily easy work, and we certainly want the work to be done in a way that helps programs grow, that is focused on quality, that is not punitive, that is really geared towards seeing where and how we can grow the best system possible. And to do that effectively, we're going to need good data, and good data takes some time, and it takes computer systems, and it takes some resources. So it is, I think, really wonderful that this committee is thinking strategically about what it's going to take to have a system like that across the state, and it's one that, quite frankly, we are looking at how those kinds of outcomes measures can be used in other after-school and summer programs in the state, and I think there's a chance here to have a model that could be helpful elsewhere as well. We always, again, try very hard to maximize state dollars, so if we can duplicate, it's always a great opportunity. Finally, though, one thing that I wanted to emphasize that I think builds on what Jackie said, but perhaps goes a little farther. YDDP has always been a program that, although it serves primarily youth who are at risk in some form or another or have some form of need, has been geared fairly broadly within the community. SDPP has been a little more focused on youth who are at risk for juvenile delinquency. We really hope that as the YDP, the new program, grows, that the focus remain broad. It's very important that the youth bureaus be able to serve all the children in the community who feel a need for their services without there necessarily having already been sort of a pre-identification in some way of them being at risk for delinquency. It is, quite frankly, always hard to know what students might need that turning point here or there, that safe space that keeps them from going in one direction, or that mentoring voice that's going to intervene when things start to go south. And so as I think part of our sense of needing to keep this within the youth bureau system as opposed to a more general placement is it also helps ensure that these funds are not going to get diverted to something that's more in the juvenile justice kind of area. Not because those funds don't need absolutely reinforcement, and we are certainly interested in and in conversations about how we can support prevention efforts in that area, but this really does serve a very particular niche that is not duplicated by any other funding stream in the state. Particularly in the summertime, having a place to go when school is not in session, you know, any child can be an at-risk child if they are home alone for 9 hours a day. And so we need to really focus on what this funding stream does that no other funding stream offers. The second area that you had asked us to speak about is summer youth employment. And I want to speak there about two incredibly valuable things about this program. The first is obviously what it does for the youth who are employed. It is a tremendous opportunity to have that first job, to get into the workforce, to have that moment of sort of pride in what you can accomplish, that sense of being able to be helpful to someone else that really is, I think, what keeps many of us working at the end of the day. But the other really core part of this program is that so many of these placements are in summer programs for younger children. In New York City, about 50% of the placements serve in summer camps. We believe that the number is approximately the same in the rest of the state. That means that these students are able, by being in those programs, to allow younger children to attend as well. Students who are over the age of 16 count in the staffing ratios for the summer programs. And so what you will often see is a senior staff member who may be a certified teacher who's, you know, looking for summer employment, or an experienced community educator, and they'll be paired with a junior staff member, an SYEP student. So that allows them to serve perhaps, you know, 15, perhaps 20, perhaps 25 kids, depending on the age of the students, whereas that senior teacher alone would only be able to serve 10. So we are very concerned that if there is a loss of the number of SYEP slots, we're going to see a corresponding decrease in the number of younger children that can be served. you know, and this unfortunately goes in general for the minimum wage to a certain extent, many of these programs, even if they're not getting SYEP dollars, hire youth in the, you know, 18, 16, 17, 18, 20 bracket at minimum wage. And that's part of how they fund or are able to sustain summer programs that serve a lot of kids. Again, it's not in any way to raise concerns about the minimum wage increase. We deeply believe in it. We know how crucial it is for the students and for the families that we're serving. But it is something that we're very glad that you're raising and really thinking through the consequences of, because we don't want to see a loss in the number of students who are getting summer programming at that younger age. We have already seen, as you know, everyone before me has testified and everyone after me will, huge cuts in these programs over the last few years, regardless. And so everything that we can do to keep the number of students served, we would be very grateful for that. So I'm happy to answer questions if there's other things that I can touch on.
Okay, sure.
Thank you.
Senator Sanders?
We're speaking about after-school youth and SYEP. What evaluations have we come up with so far to speak of the effectiveness of all of these programs?
Mm-hmm. I would think Jackie would probably have better data on the evaluations of SYEP, but I can tell you that after-school programming has gone through substantial and rigorous evaluations. The OST program, which is funded in part through YDDP dollars, has had an evaluation every year that has demonstrated effectiveness in engaging students academically, but also social emotionally. We actually just recently had a massive, they're calling it the compendium, but it's basically a sort of a compilation of 3 decades worth of research on after school. And what has become very clear through that work is that after school programs consistently increase engagement from students in the school day, which translates into long-term increases in their likelihood of graduating from high school. It also produces the kind of social-emotional skills that are getting an increasing amount of study, because economists have found that they actually are as predictive of life success as academics. So things like grit, persistence, resilience, the ability to bounce back from failure, these are all things that are really heavily nurtured by after-school programs. And so we see, particularly in student populations where they may have been experiencing a lot of failure in school, the opportunity to have what they call supported failure in after school, where you learn how to try something and try again when it doesn't work right, that is created by having this sort of little smaller student-staff ratios, the mentoring, actually can help students then translate that into academic success as they build confidence and feel more comfortable both asking for help and trying again when something doesn't work well for them.
I also share your view that the funding, or this particular funding, should be a general funding and let each area use it as they see fit in their area. Would you mind facilitating that the chair gets a copy of the compendium that you speak of?
Absolutely. Be happy to share.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Just one question. Any analysis on the impact on the minimum wage on the after school?
So in relation to this hearing, I've started asking some questions to kind of to get a sense. And the part of it is that it's going to vary quite a bit. So the more academically focused programs, Advantage After School and Extended School Day School Violence Prevention, those programs tend to hire a larger percentage of certified teachers and other folks, college students, who are going to be getting a slightly higher wage. I do think that there are going to be repercussions, actually, with the college students who are hired often as academic tutors, because as the minimum wage rises, they're going to want to increase that gap, I suspect, between the minimum wage and what they're paying the college students. But then we do also have a lot of after-school programs that do hire, again, as junior staff. And in fact, actually, some of them that deliberately do it as a youth development approach, so much like SYEP, but sort of as an internal decision. There's a program in Hudson, for instance, that has made a really fantastic training program. So their students do K-8 in the after-school program. They do 9th grade in a year-long training program on how to work with younger students, and they get hired once they hit 16, and that would be at minimum wage. So a program like that is absolutely going to see increased costs, and I'm trying to get a sense from folks of what they think those are likely to be. But at this point, I just have not, because it's going to vary so much from program to program, we haven't compiled sort of an overall assessment. But we are definitely working on it, and I will certainly share.
Okay, yeah, so Senator Sanders, our ranking member on the committee, has asked if you could also provide us with that information. That would be helpful for us.
Very happy
forward
to.
As we go through our quick deliberation around the budget and
yes.
where we're now negotiating.
Absolutely.
If the chair will endorse.
Sure.
You spoke of a innovative program in Buffalo called the CATS program, where students go to school in the morning and work in the afternoon and earn college credit.
High school credit.
High school, I
stand
corrected.
Yeah, high school credit.
I'm jumping the gun.
No worries. We wish they were able to get college credit.
Well, cats have nine lives. Let's
they
see,
do.
What,
yes.
see what we can do here.
Absolutely.
Have we tried to use this program any other place?
It's so interesting you should mention that. So I actually just made a connection this morning to a program in Long Island that's interested in duplicating this. So CATS is actually, I think, a really great example, to be honest, of why state funding is so important. CATS receives some federal funding, but they also receive ESD, SVP, school violence prevention money. And they have built over the last 8 years, basically, a variety of programs targeted to different needs. So CATS is actually a mental health provider, but they recognize that after school was a need that they were seeing in their community. And so this SYEP program grew very much out of that. They were seeing high school students who needed assistance in having enough credits to graduate, but also needed assistance in work placement. And they run all these summer programs for younger students, so they were needing assistance with workers. So it sort of was one of those perfect synergies. They took their high school program and melded it to the SYEP and figured out how to get high school credit through a principal who was really engaged in trying to serve students who were in need of credit recovery. So we are very much sharing that model and looking for other folks who want to replicate. It does take additional dollars. It is not an SYEP. The SYEP money goes to fund the students, but the money that runs that summer, that morning program, is actually separate funding that CATS has acquired.
Put me in the ballpark. What does additional dollars mean?
It probably runs them in the neighborhood of $50,000, maybe more, depending, because they have to have certified teachers to be able to get credit recovery for it. So you're talking about staffing program staff and then also hiring certified teachers and using the school building space. And then also the coordination, because they can't place all of the SYEP students in their own programs, so they share them with other summer programs in the area, but they have to do the coordination on that.
If I was a gambling man, I'd wager that Kevin Alexander back in the crowd is going to want to get some more information from you about this CATS program.
I will definitely be more than happy to speak with him. Like I said, we are one of the things that NYSAN really does our best to do is share models as we find innovative programs and try to get them out. So I'm hoping that Glen Cove, Long Island, is going to have one of these programs very shortly as well.
Great place. So. They should have it. And I can think of one or two other places.
I and you can. So absolutely. And anytime you want to talk about the funding streams that might help bring that statewide, we'd be more than happy to talk about that.
I look forward. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Eichner. Kevin Alexander, Rockaway Development Revitalization Corporation. I see y'all shook hands already, huh?
Absolutely.
No time.
Good morning, Chairman Smith and Senator Sanders. My name is Kevin Alexander, and I am the President and CEO of Rockaway Development and Revitalization Corporation, located in Far Rockaway, Queens. My perspective is going to be a little different because we are a local organization, so we look specifically at Far Rockaway and the surrounding area. And what I'd like to do basically is try and shape the conversation and sort of how summer youth connects into the broader issue of community, commercial, and economic development. A couple of things that we've done over the years to integrate the SYP program into the broader context of community development is looking at a number of the programs that we've been really fortunate to sponsor, such as the Empire Zone program, where RDOC was the administrator for over 15 years. It created incentive programs to attract businesses into the Rockaways, to strengthen local businesses through tax abatements and incentives. And it was a great way of just strengthening the local economy by working with business owners, including even the highly successful Arvin Urban Renewal Plan, which, and also attracting hundreds of businesses over the life of that program into the Rockaways, which also translated into temporary and permanent jobs. A lot of this also was supported by Senator Malcolm Smith, the then councilman, and now Senator James Smith, Assemblywoman Michelle Titus, and others. Focused on small business, entrepreneurship, and the most precious resource we have, its people. This included assisting small businesses with business planning, loan packaging, marketing, organizing merchants associations to proactively address issues such as safety, sanitation, and district marketing, assisting homeowners with our first-time home buyer and foreclosure counseling, providing innovative youth programs focused on college and career exploration and work experience. And finally, creating an innovative commercial revitalization plans to attract business and consumer spending into our shopping areas. However, our most sizable impact has been the over 10,000 youth and young adults that we have impacted over 20 years through our Summer Youth Employment Program. Now, for purposes of the remainder of my testimony, I'm going to focus on how one of the ways in which RDRC has been able to transform the SYP program, which is normally perceived as just a social program, into our biggest economic, what I call, game changer for over 125 to 150 small businesses, local daycare centers, summer camps, hospitals, medical centers, and nursing homes located throughout the Rockaways. The SYP program enables small businesses that rely on seasonal spikes in visitors to our beach, bay, boardwalks, concessions, parks, and natural beauty to hire up for the summer months that they could not otherwise afford to do on their own. Our summer youth program provides, on average, 600 deserving youth with the opportunity to earn a paycheck while they learn valuable lessons about work that includes customer service, how to follow directions, punctuality, courtesy, respect, and proper attire in the workplace. The majority of our worksite sponsors include local businesses who annually embrace the opportunity to interact with our local youth and increase their sales and services workforce in time for the seasonal spikes of beachgoers, day trippers, and explorers into the Rockaways again. In addition, SYP provides each selected participant the ability to work up to 25 hours per week for 7 weeks at $7.25 per hour. Aggregately, this equates into $760,000 of additional wages that has a multiplier effect on our local economy that includes, one, the opportunity to introduce 600 youth to the world of work, two, the 125-plus participating businesses benefiting from increased productivity, three, the 5 to 7 seasonal employees RDRC hires to monitor the 125 work sites and 600 youth. And fourth, the reinvestment of $760,000 in earned income by our participants who shop locally. Now, why this seems impressive, it's clearly not enough when you consider that 3 out of every 4 of our applicants are rejected due to the lack of funding. We just simply have no choice but to turn away 3 times the number of applicants that we can enroll into SYP. In addition to providing our SYP applicant participants with job readiness training, RDRC has increased its efforts to provide financial education workshops and information focused on budgeting, understanding credit, the difference between banks and financial centers, aka check cash and businesses. Second, the SYP enables us to develop a longer-term relationship with many of our youth, especially high school juniors and seniors who are interested in enrolling in our highly competitive in-school youth program that consistently places over 90% of the 40 participants into college, and has also produced recently several valedictorians and salutatorians as well. We believe that the SYP doesn't indeed have a measurable impact on the youth and young adults that have graced us. I hope that you can appreciate even more our sense of urgency to rebuild, restore, and rejuvenate our community and local economy post-Sandy. With over 350 of the 1,000 businesses severely damaged by or destroyed by flooding, fire, wind, power outages, and other challenges, including the lack of financial resources, insurance gaps, and loss of the consumer base, our business owners are in no position to hire up for the upcoming summer. I've been on record stating that the Rockaways could lose up to 50% of its small businesses, which would have a significant impact on taxes, including property, sales, and employment. Increased local employment rate in areas that are already grappling with an over 15% unemployment rate prior to Sandy. Now, my comments on the proposed minimum wage increase, definitely in favor, but not at the expense of losing existing slots for SYP or any other youth program. So that's the dilemma right now. So at a time where we know that less businesses that voluntarily will opt out of the SYP to pay for that summer youth, that youth worker to come in, are not going to have the resources. So it's, again, going to have a multiplier effect in areas that have been really devastated by Sandy. And that's a growing concern for us. What do we do with the number of youth that we have in the Rockaways that just don't get selected through a lottery system, that want to work and be productive? And those are my comments. Thank you.
Senator Sanders, ranking member, Social Services Committee.
Thank you. Explain this lottery. We've been hearing this quite often today. Why don't you explain for the record, what is this lottery and how does it take place?
Well, the City of New York has contracted out to a private company, and the lottery is done basically electronically. So the agencies we're encouraged to have applicants apply online, register online. Unfortunately, in areas like the Rockaways, there are a lot of our families and homeowners and renters don't have computers or computers with internet access in the home. So we probably produce about 1,500 applications a year that are completed. We then submit those back to this entity, and they basically run the lottery. So it's not really it is not controlled through the city or through the organization such as RDRC. It's done by a third party. And they do several runs probably within a month based on the number of slots that you have. So the challenge that we have, for instance, and the commissioner talked about it, I think, briefly when Senator Smith, you asked the question, how nimble can you be when the slots are going up and down? For a small organization that has a summer youth program of three persons, it's very difficult to sort of be that nimble because there are a lot of things that you have to do administratively. So if we start with 300 slots and all of a sudden we get a call saying, go to 400, it has a real challenge for a small organization to move that nimbly. So the more advanced planning that we have, knowing the number of slots that we have, of course, we will never turn anything away, but it just means it becomes a challenge. So, Senator, it's a third-party entity that's been created to take the data, do the applications, run the lottery.
You also spoke of a multiplier effect, the $760,000. If you could explain the multiplier effect a little bit more to us.
Well, what we did was we looked at the number of slots that we presently have at 600, and we look at the number of weeks, 7, the number of hours, 25, and the current minimum wage. And so we come up with that gross number of $760,000, being that they are tax exempt or don't pay employer taxes. Roughly, probably about $725 goes into their pockets. This in turn enables them to purchase a lot of the things that they need for the upcoming school year. A lot of our participants shop locally because we're on a peninsula. So they do a lot of their shopping there. So that means that they're earning an income, working in the Rockaways primarily. When they get paid, we want them to make smart decisions, but then they're reinvesting back in the local economy. So the businesses also benefit from that. The second thing is that the businesses are not paying for this if they agree to become a worksite sponsor. So they're able to staff up or employ up, as I call it, without necessarily taking on the burden of paying the additional employer wages. So they get the benefit of that as well. They also get the benefit, and this is probably the most important thing I see when you talk about commercial revitalization, is getting your merchants and business owners to understand that youth is a not just a resident, but they're a consumer. And they have to connect to that consumer base, because unfortunately most of our youth usually spend, always not the wisest of ways, but they spend. So that's a base for them as well. And so that's the multiplier effect that we take a look at.
To underline your point, sir, in Keynesian economics, one of the best ways of stimulating an economy is to give money to poor people, because they are going to invest it in their everyday needs and not into luxury yachts and things of this nature. Thank you very much. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Senator. Just one question, and thank you for traveling all the way from the Rockaways up here on
his
underscores.
Yacht.
By his yacht? You never told me you had a yacht now.
I'm going to go look for it now.
Well, it obviously underscores the significance of it. Just one question. You, on an average, have 600 slots.
Yes.
Did you do any analysis on the impact of if the minimum wage goes from 725 to 875 or 9? Does that turn your slots into half? And if so, what would that number or that multiplier effect that Senator Sanders talked about be? I mean, does it cut it in half or a third? Just
if we're at 600 now, we probably would be at about 450. Looking at, I think Queens overall gets about 6,000 slots, or 22% of the 30,000. So roughly, we could lose up to about 150 slots.
In Queens?
Well, in the Rockaways. In Queens, we would probably go, honestly, from 6,000 or 6,200 down to maybe about 4,500. If I know the formula correctly, in terms of what Commissioner said, 22%.
So just one question, because you made an interesting comment in the opening statement that you support the minimum wage, but not at the expense of losing slots. So my question is, if we could not compensate for the loss in slots this time around in terms of the budget, where they're talking about, I think, 12 to 19 million that would keep them at 35 million or so, and they wouldn't have to lose any slots. Would you say that we should not increase the minimum wage and so that we can maintain all the slots that we have, or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Just to chime in,
sure.
One proposal, which I do not agree with, but one proposal was said to have a training wage, an entry-level minimum wage, which might deal with your issue a little bit better. I don't agree with it, mind you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Kevin Douglas, United Neighborhood Housing Services of New York, and then our final speaker will be Dr. Amy Ellen Schwartz. Is Dr. Amy Ellen Schwartz here? No?
Nope. Okay. Got a little time.
Okay, well maybe you might be the final speaker.
Let me take all the time that's left.
Okay.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for having me here. My name is Kevin Douglas. I'm a policy analyst with United Neighborhood Houses of New York. We're the nonprofit association of 38 settlement houses throughout New York City. We're neighborhood centers. They do everything from cradle to grave, so to speak, early childhood education, after school, workforce development, adult literacy, senior services, the whole gamut. And they really attempt to bring those together to serve families as a whole. Collectively, our network serves about 500,000 New Yorkers a year. And because we're located in some of the highest need communities, part of the most important work we do is really around workforce development and youth development work. So that clearly relates to the topic of today's hearing around SYP, YDDP, and the impact of the minimum wage. Before I get into the impact of, you know, the minimum wage on these programs, I want to be very clear that we are definitely in support of an increase in the minimum wage. There's lots of research out there that indicates that this is a significant need for New York State. I say this would impact about 1 million New Yorkers in terms of people that are close to the minimum wage, slightly above it. In terms of if you bump it up, they're going to see a benefit. In terms of how that relates to youth, also the Fiscal Policy Institute found that almost 20% of the kids in the state who have a parent working at minimum wage would benefit from this. It's 860,000. And it's hard to divorce the impact that a minimum wage increase would have on parents from, you know, the impact that it has on children working through programs or SYP. So even though there's a negative effect, if you will, if there's not an increased investment, we certainly support an increase in the minimum wage. It's long overdue, and we think the time for it is now. And not just to increase it, but to make sure it's indexed for inflation,
right,
so that we maintain the value of that into the future. As you know, it's been a number of years since the wage was last increased, and we don't want to get into a position where we increase it this year, and then we revisit it 10 years later and find out again that it's not meeting people's needs. So I just want to be very clear that we certainly support an increase in the wage. The commissioner earlier mentioned that there used to be a significant source of federal funding that supported SYP. When the Job Training Partnership Act was phased out in 1999, replaced by Workforce Investment Act, WIA, that funding was unfortunately, it went away. And so United Neighborhood Houses, along with the Neighborhood Family Services Coalition, formed the Campaign for Summer Jobs. You've been a tremendous supporter of ours up here in Albany over the years. I want to thank you for that. We bring a couple hundred youth up here to meet with legislators and really talk about the importance of the program. And we're really focused not only making sure there's adequate resources at the city level and the state level, but that there's a good programmatic model behind it. So in terms of the importance of SYP, I don't imagine I need to convince you of the benefits, and we have a number of people have spoken to it already, but I just want to highlight a couple of them. Probably the most important one is really the fact that this is the first work opportunity for youth. It makes a huge difference if you get your first job at 14 or if you get your first job at 18 and have no work experience. So the ability to be in a safe environment with supportive adults and be able to make a mistake. You show up for work late, you're not going to get fired. They're going to say, look, you're working now, this is the expectation, you have to be on time. They can teach people about money management, learn about punctuality, respect, communication, getting along with their peers, and just really what it means to be a responsible worker, developing what we call soft work skills. And those are absolutely critical to develop at a young age. And there's research out of Northeastern University that has found that when youth work during their high school years, they're more likely to work after high school at more sustained rates, and they also have higher lifetime earnings. So we know that in terms of long-term impact, youth employment is very important. I don't want to steal her thunder. I know the NYU is here today to talk about the benefits of the program academically. Very briefly, they have found that it improves academic outcomes, attendance, that sort of thing. So there's very significant benefits to that extent as well. The prior gentleman talked about the impact in the Rockaways of $760,000 in terms of spending in the community. If you extrapolate that out into New York City, SYP is a highly kind of, there's not a lot of admin associated with it. Almost all of the money that goes to the program goes directly back into the community. So as a whole, if you look at New York City last year, the program was about $43 million total. Almost $38 million of that went back into communities in terms of spending. As the commissioner mentioned, they're spending on food, clothing, supporting their families, and they're also opening savings accounts. So we know that there's a real impact economically as well. The challenge for us is that even though there's widespread recognition of the value of SYP, the money isn't always there. And you know, people will say we support it, but our hands are tied, we have a limited amount of money. And over the years, we've seen significant disinvestment in the program. Obviously, the stimulus dollars were only time limited, and when those went away, there was, you know, significant impact on the program in the city. The city tax levy contributions have fallen over the years. And at the state, we saw a tremendous decrease from the days where we were seeing $35 million a year. It dropped down to 15 and a half. And we are grateful, very grateful last year that the legislature worked with the governor to increase it to $25 million and is proposed to do the same this year. However, because SYP is so wage dependent, we know that there'll be a significant drop off in the number of youth that are able to be served if we don't increase investment in the program. The commissioner mentioned we're looking for $35 million, and I know there were some questions from Senator Martins about how that number was arrived at, and as you're looking at there, there's a number of charts in front of you that kind of explain, based on the different options, the number of hours youth are working, their wages, how you actually back into that number. And I want to be clear that that $10 million figure isn't just representative of New York City. We know that's what it would cost. The portion of that goes to New York City would be sufficient to cover our slot loss in the increase of a minimum wage increase to $8.75 or $9 an hour. New York City gets about 54% of that funding, and the rest is spread throughout the state, and so we anticipate that they will have similar needs. So I want to be clear that that $10 million would benefit the whole state, and the overall ask is for $35 million. In terms of kind of the either or, you know, either you raise the minimum wage and if you don't come up with the money for the programs, it's a problem. I don't see these as kind of mutually exclusive. I think the right thing to do for New York is that we make sure we increase the minimum wage. It's going to help their families who are working. It's going to help the children in their families. But then we also have to make sure that we put the investment into YDDP, SYEP, and I don't see those as separate. These are both things that we'd encourage the legislature to do. In terms of the broader impact, you asked earlier about YDDP, and I know we're not just focusing on SYEP. Nora alluded to briefly the fact that many SYEP workers actually work in day camps, summer camps. In the city, this out-of-school time, OST, this provides affordable childcare for parents during the summer. And as was mentioned, a lot of the SYEP workers go to those camps, and we have members that have said, if I have less youth working in my summer camp, that's going to impact the quality of services, it's going to put financial strain on my program, and that's going to directly impact the working families who depend on those programs. So we want to make sure that that's considered as well. Beyond the fact that there would be an impact through a minimum wage increase, we also want to highlight the fact that YDDP has shrunk dramatically over the years. Just a few years ago, it was $28 million. It was proposed to be cut in half by the governor. The legislature added a little bit more last year. So even in the event that the minimum wage were not to go up, we want to see a restoration to that funding because it does support these critical after-school and summer programs for youth. And lastly, in terms of minimum wage and the impact on SYP, you have the charts in front of you there. We're projecting if you increase the minimum wage to $8.75, the slot loss is around $3,700. If you increase it to $9, the slot loss is around $4,200. These are really estimates, and they're really our best understanding at this point. I really want to underscore the fact, though, that even if the minimum wage were not to increase the session, regardless of whether it's phased in July or January, that SYP is at a historic all-time low as it is now. Last year, the city had about 29,000 youth in the program, and this is out of over 132,000 that applied. It means over 100,000 youth who wanted something positive to do over the summer, wanted some money in their pocket, wanted to help their families, said no, sorry. And that's not just last year. That's happened in each of the last 3 years. We've turned away over 100,000 youth. And that has significant consequences. We know in New York City there's about 200,000 disconnected youth. These are the youth that aren't connected to work. They're not connected to employment. And if we want to kind of combat that crisis and get them involved in the workforce and education, we can't say no to them when they show up in their earlier years trying to get a job. So we would really push for this increase in $35 million for SYP, regardless of whether the minimum wage is increased. And we certainly support that. You know, you intimated this is something that you guys are working on, and we really see it as a significant need in the community. So I guess really in closing, support minimum wage increase. It's important. We need to do it now. We also know that youth employment, youth development programs impact the same families, and we also need to support those as well. So thank you for your support of the campaign for summer jobs over the years, and be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. You had mentioned at least 100,000 youth who applied and were unsuccessful. The lottery did not work well for them. I would also draw to your attention, of course, this 100,000 does not even include the discouraged youth, those who felt that it would not happen, it would not work. Those numbers could go as far as high as 300,000 or something of that nature. I wanted to draw your attention to a side effect of all of these things with Senator Smith has some initiatives out, and among his initiatives, he's been a champion against the concept of sagging, and one of the most successful ways of combating this social phenomenon is a job. People who are in a job have a standard of dress that they must adhere to. And the failure to do that means that your job prospects sag. So under those conditions, one of the best things that we can do if we were serious about that problem is to help people become socialized into the world of work. Thank you very much, Senator and Chair.
Your testimony speaks for itself in the data.
Good stuff.
I know that we are conducting these hearings just for this kind of information, because as we began running through the budget, and the details, as they say, is the devil is always in the details. You know, the question started arising, you know, great minimum wage, and we all support that. There's no question about it. But then there's those unintended consequences, which we fail to look at. Not that from any shortcomings, but it's just that we're rushing to the end of the door because we see that light, and we want to make sure we get there before it closes. And then when you get there, you forgot that you didn't bring all the chairs with you. And so appreciate your testimony, and you know, I just hope you'll be around if we need you during this final days in budget negotiation, if we need someone to come and provide some information or some of our colleagues.
Certainly appreciate the opportunity to testify and to provide resources as you need them in the future. And just to quickly respond to your statement, we actually saw that. When the federal money went away, when the city cut their money, when the state cut their money, kids were getting rejected. And because it's a lottery system, they were getting rejected one year, second year in a row, third year in a row. And we actually saw the numbers of youth actually start to decrease in terms of the number that were applying because of the discouraged worker phenomenon. So we know that this doesn't even begin to talk about the universe of need and the youth that are interested because there's this unintended consequence. So we appreciate that you guys are paying attention to the issue.
Thank you. Let me thank all of you who are here today. Our last speaker, Dr. Amy Ellen Schwartz, her train is late, so we may have her testimony read into the record. But I do want to thank my colleagues who is here, our ranking member on social services, Senator Sanders, and also Senator Martin. I want to also thank our team who is here because obviously, as senators, we look good at the table, but it's our staff that makes us look good. Our counsel to the committee was Paul Nichols, who's back there. He's been running in and out, so you may not have seen him. And obviously, you met earlier Beth Clemente, she was here as well. Anne-Marie Costello, press secretary, who has recently come on board. My chief of staff is in the back, Meredith Henderson. We have our media and production team over there. They're just working hard. You won't even hear them. You don't hear them, but they've done tremendous work. And we've been streaming live this hearing as well. And our center photographer, who just left as well. So we appreciate everybody who came today. This was very compelling testimony. It'll be very helpful to us as we're moving forward. If you are around today, the Senate is putting out their One House resolution. I suggest that you read the resolution very carefully, look to see where we may have had some impact, and if not, don't think all hope is lost. That is only the One House resolution. We will be looking towards doing our budget and printing bills sometime in the latter part of next week, and so your input consistently from this point forward will be very appreciative. We wanted to highlight the significance of increasing the minimum wage, which we support, but also we wanted to highlight the significance of what that would mean to the lack of slots, as most people were looking at sort of a one-way mirror. We'll just give you more money for the minimum wage, period. We did our job. We want you to recognize that, yes, you can do that, but you also have to increase certain areas, some youth employment, after-school network, YDDP, all of that needs to be compensated for when that occurs. So we thank you very much for supporting that argument for us, and your testimony will be used as we go forward convincing our colleagues. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity to give testimony today. I appreciate the commitment of the New York State Committee on Social Services to improving youth development in New York. My name is Amy Ellen Schwartz. I am the director of the Institute for Education and Social Policy at NYU. I'm also a professor of public policy, education, and economics at the Wagner School and Steinhardt School at the university. My research is in applied econometrics, focusing on issues in urban policy, education, and public finance. Today, I will give you an overview of our research and discuss the potential positive effects on youth outcomes of the Summer Youth Employment Program, SYEP. I'll highlight our findings and share our plans to expand the research in the future. But I shouldn't go farther without saying that our research would not have been possible without the efforts of my co-authors, Jake Leo Zerbel, Merrill Weinstein, and Beth Weitzman, and equally important, the collaboration of the New York City Department of Youth and Community Development, the New York City Department of Education, the U.S. Department of Labor, and the Spencer Foundation, who provided support. I imagine you've heard some of this already. Nonetheless, for completeness, let me say a few words about what is SYEP from our point of view. The SYEP is administered by New York City's Department of Youth and Community Development. For SYEP, all New York City youth ages 14 to 24 are eligible to participate in a program. Youth apply through community-based organizations throughout the city. These serve as intake sites. They supervise job placements, and they provide training. Participants work in entry-level jobs in the nonprofit, private, and public sectors. Placements with summer camps and daycare centers are most common, but there are others. Participants work up to 25 hours a week for 7 weeks in the summer, and they earn the New York State minimum wage. 10% of these hours are devoted to education and training. Today I'll be talking about research that focuses on the New York City high school students who apply to SYEP, but I should note that kids who are no longer in high school and who are not yet in high school are also eligible. Before we turn to numbers, we should ask, why do we think SYEP might work and why it might have a positive effect? There are many reasons to think that SYEP would have a positive effect on youth outcomes. Kids may learn new skills, gain responsibility, gain self-esteem, and general knowledge of workplace expectations. Even for those doing menial tasks, it could give them a view into what their future would look like without further education. But it could also give a window into what it might look like if they gain more education. Prior research also suggests that keeping youth engaged in productive activities helps prevent negative outcomes that could interfere with their educational success. These are all the same kinds of reasons that middle-class parents give for why they engage their own children in summer jobs or other positive experiences during the summer. That said, we know that money makes a difference, and money makes people better off. SYEP provides income for New York City youth during the summer. Students who apply to SYEP are overwhelmingly low income. Approximately 90% are eligible for free or reduced price lunch. So the summer income may also reduce the amount of time that students need to spend during the school year on part-time after-school jobs, or may just give them some money to afford supplementary materials. So how do we estimate the impact? That's kind of the big question. What difference does it make? So on the whole, estimating the impact of summer opportunities is very challenging. Often there's a worry that youth who apply for jobs and who get jobs are different than those who don't apply or who don't get jobs. They're more motivated, they're more responsible. In particular, when we aren't able to see anything but the difference between some kids having jobs and some kids not, it's hard to pick apart what's causing what. In this example, we are able to make use of an important decision that SYEP made some years ago, which is to allocate the available jobs using a random assignment procedure. So rather than first come, first serve, or subjective criteria, since the demand for SYEP exceeds the available spots, they wait until everybody has had an opportunity to apply for a job, and then they have a lottery. This is the gold standard for estimating impacts through program evaluation, because the difference is between the kids who were given the jobs and those who were not is really nothing. It was random. Okay, so I'd be happy to talk more about what are the outcomes and what are the details of the process. But let me cut to findings. We looked at the short-term effects of winning that lottery. We looked at attendance. We looked at attempting standardized tests in the year following participation. And we looked at the pass rates on English and math Regents exams. We only looked in this first study at public school students who applied to SYEP in 2007. So we matched this data from DYCD to data from the New York City Department of Education files through a student ID, created these matches, and we looked What happened to these 36,630 SYEP applicants? I say the number out loud because it's a big number. This is not a small-scale experimental program. There aren't questions here about is it scalable, is it replicatable. This is at scale. So it's really quite remarkable. What we find is what I would describe as modest positive effects on attendance, and particularly among those students who are at greatest educational risk, those students who are 16 years or older, have not so perfect attendance. These are the students who show the greatest gains. We find that SYEP increases the probability of attempting and then passing English and math Regents exams, again, for these students who are ages 16 and older, particularly with those with low prior school attendance. For these students, SYEP increases the probability of attempting the English Regents by almost 3% and of passing by 2%. For math, the increase is 1.2% for attempting and 1.3% for passing. This amounts to about 100 more kids passing these exams each year. These findings, we believe, suggest that even though the explicit goal of the program is on workforce readiness, the program has a broader impact on youth, including an increase in school attendance, the attempts that students have at taking tests, which is, as you know, the first step toward passing, and then ultimately on their success at passing Regents exams. These are really important milestones. You cannot graduate high school if you don't go to school. You cannot pass the exams if you don't sit for the exams. And this is putting kids on the path toward graduation. In our future work, we want to understand a lot more about this. We want to know what happens if we look at different years. This is a single year of data, at one point in our economic cycle. It's an open question still how the impacts are sensitive to differences in the unemployment rate generally. We also haven't looked at all at the long-run outcomes. Does this short-term success translate into continued success in the next year and the year after? Are there long-run effects on high school graduation? Are there long-run effects on college going? These are all really important questions, all trying to help us understand how it is that what a kid does in the summer, and particularly if they get a job, shapes their future success and workforce readiness. Thank you again for your time and for allowing me to share our findings in support of SYEP and youth development programs.
Are you guys doing a study right now? Are you preparing to do a study on other years?
We have, DYCD has shared with us the data, and we got a small grant from the Spencer Foundation to do the data match. So we're doing some work along those lines and doing what always seems like the hardest part of this kind of project, which is raising the money. So we have submitted a grant proposal to the U.S. Department of Education in the hopes that they would help us fund this agenda. A particular challenge in this kind of work is that this is crossing domains. We're asking whether a program that's about giving kids jobs has educational effects, following the idea that down the line, this is the path toward better labor market outcomes. This is the path toward economic independence. But we're not looking at sort of the traditional things either group looks at. So the Department of Education, the U.S. Department of Education, many departments of education, focus a lot of their attention on how what you do in the school building during the school day shapes how students do on the tests you give them and on future education. On the other side, there's all this there's interest for those who are doing workforce things on how, what are the workforce outcomes? And I think this sort of project and this sort of work that understands these things go together is really important, and it's cutting edge. It's in a sense remarkable that we're the first folks to be doing this, But there you have it, trying to ask what does this job mean for a child's development into an adult is going to mean looking at a lot of different directions. This piece, we're interested in looking at education. In the longer run, you would want to look at how they fare. Do kids stay out of trouble? So many people would say, "What, you know, you want to keep kids from just wasting their time, getting into trouble in the summer." So maybe that's part of what's going on. Just a really open question also about what works best. Is it the combination of doing some training, doing some work? What kind of work works best for whom? Are there kids who are most at risk? Can we identify groups that should be targeted? All open questions. So we see our work cut out for us. Well, thank you.
Short-term period, or maybe several years out after having had the summer employment? And then I guess the other question would be, in the research, are you taking into account, I guess, the type of summer job the children had? So some kids that had certain jobs did better than others that had...
Two great
that
questions.
That might be too expansive, though.
Two great staff. Questions. So in terms of how long we plan to track them, our current plan is to track them as long as they are at in New York City public schools. Now, in part, that's a matter of convenience. So it might not sound like that, but matching and finding kids and tracking people is actually hard. But because with the support of the New York City Department of Education, we're able to match onto education data, we can track them through the New York City Department of Education administrative data as they move from one high school to another, take one exam. So what happens then after they leave? We have a plan, if we can, to track them if they go into the City University of New York, with whom we have already an agreement to allow us to track them in. But for now, that's about as far as that's about as far as my energy can take me. You know, if we can get through that far and we still see effects, you can bet I'll be coming back and thinking, okay, now what do we do next? But, it's possible that we see effects peter out, and it's possible that we see, we have just too hard a time tracking kids. So we'll see. Now, about which jobs matter most, we're looking into it. It seems our first pass will probably be to look at the different community-based organizations, because the jobs match so tightly onto which CBO they're working with. Mm-hmm. So there are CBOs for whom, for which virtually all the jobs are kind of summer camp related. Mm-hmm. So you're just never going to tell the difference between that. Some are going in another direction, giving some a broader array. But I think we don't now know what each kid is doing. We know in a detailed way to be able to say we know what tasks they're doing. Again, should the U.S. Department of Education be willing to support the project, as we hope they will, we do plan to do a survey of kids, of students, both participants and applicants, who were not offered positions, because it's important to find out what are the other kids doing. And if the other kids are getting worse jobs or doing nothing, that'll tell us a lot. So we're going to hope to learn about both groups. And maybe over time develop ways to get more insight into it. It's this is the upside of it being a big group is it's a big group. And as I said, this is not some designer, hothouse program that you would then say, well, that worked in the lab, is that going to work if you try to do it for a lot of kids? But the other side is we have to work to some extent with those kinds of data you can get for large groups. So we're hoping to balance that, if we can do some focus groups at the community-based organizations as well, to just have some sense of what a, you know, what do they think, and what's their experience. So,
because one of the things that I've seen before, because you know we work in the legislature, and a number of individuals, the youth in particular, that come and get exposed to an atmosphere
right.
for the purposes of a job, they end up liking it and come back. So to the extent that you know your study may track,
absolutely,
and which you know young people get exposed to a career, and then them either end up taking that in
right.
their studies and education, and then ultimately maybe even coming back to having that be their you know permanent profession.
Well, let me give you an example of another mechanism. One of the fabulous things this does for kids is it starts to connect them to the financial services sector. 15-year-olds can be getting ATM cards. Now, I understand they don't pay them, you know, in cash like you get paid to babysit. They'll give them an ATM card of some variety or some bank card so that they can access their money. And this may be the very first time these kids will have seen this, and they might never have for quite a long time. Mm. So this, it's a completely different mechanism. This isn't going to affect your ability to, you know, your school outcomes, but it could very much affect your ability to conceive of saving, banking, connecting, loans, you know, it's an entree to a world that many low-income kids will not have. So I'm a huge fan of this program because it's so multifaceted in ways of introducing students to a world that they might not otherwise see. So, you know, long run of life, I hope to come back and be able to tell you, and we've done this great study of banking.
Fantastic.
You know, one piece at a time.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Thank you.